graduation recognition Sunday. So after worship this morning, please plan on staying, and we're going to have some cake and listen to what our graduating seniors are up to or planning on, or just plain celebrate the fact that they're graduating seniors. Yay. Good job, team. And then be church together, and then we'll present them with their quilts that Dee has been working. Dee has pretty much spent the pandemic working on quilts for our youth group, for our graduating seniors. So we'll present since August, yes. So we'll present them to the seniors, and then we'll send them on their way with a blessing and a prayer. So please stay if you're able to for a little bit of cake and celebration today. And then it's also the last day of Sunday school today. So when you see our Sunday school teachers, give them a high five and tell them thank you for every week teaching our young people in faith. It's been another good year, and I don't believe we missed a single Sunday school service, Sunday school day, due to the pandemic. If we did, it was a very short little gap, because between Zoom and between online and in person and outdoors, and we pretty much did it all. So good job, Sunday school teachers. But that did not lapse in the middle of everything. Gwen's like, yay, high five. Yep. Okay. So Sunday school, however, does not end, because Sunday school is over, but that means there's time for Vacation Bible School. Yay! So it's Superhero Vacation Bible School this year. We're going to study Christ, who is our superhero, and then learn the stories of faith from people who are in the scriptures. So that is June 8th through the 10th. Please bring as many friends as you'd like to. If you have grandkids or family members who are out of town and they're coming to visit, they're welcome to come and join us for Vacation Bible School. And if you have neighbor kids around the community, please invite them to come and join us. It will be a week, a three-day little adventure of fun. We're going to start at 5:30 with dinner for everybody, and then there'll be an opening, and then music, games, and crafts, and snacks, and yeah, it's just a fun week together. So please spread the word. And if you're able to, there's a sign-up sheet on the table for volunteers. We need volunteers of all kinds. The more hands that we have, the more fun the week is, and the better job that we can do together. So please sign up on the table if you're able to help with that. And let's see. There's an announcement about Lutheran Marriage Encounter Experience. They're doing an online version of this right now. If you're at all interested, this is not really marriage counseling. It's more of a retreat to, like, sort of spend time together as a couple talking about life and maybe finding a little bit of time apart, just set aside to be a couple when life is as hectic and busy as it is. So if you're interested in that, you can register online. There's information on how to do that in the bulletin. The last thing I'd really like to note and draw attention to is on the church office door, there's a whole sign-up sheet for worship volunteers. And you don't have to sign up to be a worship volunteer. You can just tell us that you'd like to, and then we'll assign a place for you to serve if you're able to. But if you're looking at the summer schedule and going, wow, there's this and that I'm kind of busy with, you could sign up for times that would work for you. And then we won't schedule you for a time that won't. So on the office door, if you're interested in that, please take time to sign up. Other announcements to make note of today? Others in our prayers that we should make note of? Then let's begin our worship. We begin by rising and confessing our sins and hearing God's promise of forgiveness and grace. Hallelujah! Christ is risen! Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sins, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to your people, come help your people, turning us from our sins to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together in Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power of the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace. Let us pray. Gracious and glorious God, you have chosen us as your own, and by the powerful name of Christ, you protected us from every evil. By your Spirit, transform us in your beloved world, that we may find joy in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Our first reading comes to us from the book of Acts, chapter 1. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, together the crowd numbered about 120 people, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who was to become a guide for those who arrested Jesus. And he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. So one of the men who has accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two. Joseph called Barabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in the ministry and the apostleship from which Judah turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord. Our second reading comes to us from the first book, from 1 John book, chapter number 5. "If we receive human testimony, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God that he has testified to his Son. Those who believe in the Son of God have the testimony in their hearts. Those who do not believe in God have made him a liar by not believing in the testimony that God has given concerning his Son. And this is the testimony: God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life." The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to John, the 17th chapter. Jesus prayed, "I have made your name known to those that you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know the truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in my name, in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you had given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I am speaking these things in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given you them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I am asking you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in the truth. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. And at this time, I would invite all of our Sunday school students to come forward at this time. Holy cow, Gwen, you broke your foot. Are you okay?
Yeah.
All right, that's a pretty cool pink cast. So today is the last day of Sunday school, and we have much to be thankful for. What are some of the things that you are thankful for about Sunday school this year? Yeah? Something to be thankful for Sunday school this year? We got to be with people. That was huge, wasn't it? It was pretty lonely for a while, right? Huge deal to get to be with people. What else? Have you learned anything in Sunday school this year? No. No. Did you learn anything in Sunday school this year? What? Learned about God in Sunday school this year. Yep. What are some other things you learned? How great God is. Did you learn anything about prayer in Sunday school this year? And prayer? Yep. Anything interesting you've learned this year, Avery? No. Okay. Well, I think that every year we should take time to be thankful for little things. Because, you know, do you ever think that the Sunday school is something that you get to be thankful for? It's kind of cool to get to have a place to come where we have church friends, right? I'm often thankful for my church friends. And Sunday school is probably the first place where I really got to start to get to know church friends. But they're a gift, right? And sometimes we don't list them as like, wow, thanks God for those church friends. But you know what? Those church friends are pretty important, especially when we're having hard times, because they're the people that sort of tend to pray for us. And they're also the ones that are sort of they're just there sometimes in special kind of ways. And what else can we be thankful for when it comes to Sunday school? What were some of the fun things you did this year? Yeah. We learned about the miracles. Yes. Does God ever do miracles for us? Yeah. Yeah. They might not look like exactly like the miracles in the Bible, but if we're watching, there's little miracles that God does for us all the time, right? Yep, so we're thankful for that and for the chance to like learn about the Bible, because that doesn't happen everywhere. Yep. How about our teachers? Thankful for our teachers. They love us too. Yep. What else? Ooh, you got a mustard seed. That's pretty cool. Did you learn about that this year in Sunday school? Faith like a mustard seed? Yep. How about music? Do any singing? Yep. So we're thankful for that. I think today, when you're spending time in Sunday school with your teachers, I would like you to think about and just pay attention to all of the little things that are kind of awesome about Sunday school and about your church, and to give thanks. And then I'd like you to continue it all week long when you go to school. What do you have thanks in school to give? What do you have thanks to give for God for like the things that happen in school? Okay? Because maybe there's some not so great things that happen in school sometimes, but there's some pretty great stuff that happens almost every day in school too, right? And when you're at home and it's time for dinner, even if it's not your favorite meal, because sometimes that happens, I want you to think about all the things that there are to give thanks there for. And the little stuff that happens every day, I'd like you to try this week to find the stuff that, to find in just about every moment something to be thankful for, even the moments that you're not overly thankful for. Like sometimes in my house it might be, my mom made me practice piano again, right? That might be something that we're not always thankful for, right? Except for, it's kind of cool to be able to have a piano and to be able to sing and have music time, right? So even then, there's something to be thankful for. And sometimes, if we get into the process, the Bible says a gazillion times over to be thankful. And I think the older I get, the reason I think that it's there is because we can do a lot of grumbling, right? And when we grumble, it doesn't tend to make our hearts very happy, right? But we can also be people who look for the joys, right? And if we teach ourselves to look for the joys that God gives us, suddenly, even though there's things to grumble about, our heart becomes happier. So today, we're going to give thanks for our Sunday school teachers and our Sunday school time. But all week long, I want you to think about the things that there are to give thanks for every single day, okay? And I have a little thing, because I think we should actually tell our Sunday school teachers thank you today. So I brought a surprise for them. So why don't we have our Sunday school teachers come forward today? Jeannie Stelmack is one of our Sunday school teachers who's here with us today. And Jill Teachout isn't necessarily a Sunday school teacher by right, but she's been our substitute this year. So if Jill could come forward too, that'd be awesome. Come here, guys. Let's give them a surprise. Instead of chocolate for you today, we're going to give something to somebody else today. Okay, give them a hug and tell them thank you this morning. Okay, let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for this year of learning and for all of the time that we spent together. Even when we can't come up with things right off the top of our heads, Lord God, this time is a gift. Fill us with your love and give us reasons and help us to see the reasons that there are to be thankful every day. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for coming up today. And thank you, Sunday school teachers. Let's give them a round of applause this morning. Grace and peace to this day from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I remember the first time my brother and sister-in-law went on vacation just after they were married, and they had to leave their dog behind. So their dog came to stay with me because they were headed out on a train someplace. I don't know, you know, by that time in my life, I'd been a youth director for a really long time, and I'd been a pastor for a couple of years, and, you know, people trusted me with a lot of things. So I guess I didn't really think that a dog was going to be a huge, huge challenge that would take lots and lots of training and instruction, because, you know, I guess I kind of thought I was pretty responsible most of the time. But the dog came with four pages of nicely written out, every notebook page filled instructions on how to care for the dog. And I read the instructions and I was like, wow. Okay, so I can only give them so much food and only in the morning, and you know, there's a schedule for when they have to go out every day, and I had no idea that dogs came with so much instructions, to be absolutely honest. And as I'm driving them, my brother and sister-in-law, to the train station, I'm secretly, inwardly praying that somehow or another I don't screw up the dog while they're gone, because seriously, I wasn't sure if we'd like actually make it as a family if I messed up the dog. The dog and I got along famously, by the way. We had a great week. When my sister-in-law and brother came back, they found me and the dog sitting by my refrigerator, looking inside of it together, trying to decide what we should make for supper that night. And my sister-in-law said something with a grumble in her voice like, "I just knew it, she'd spoil the dog while I was gone." I might have done that. But we had a good week and the dog lived, so it was all good. But every time I read this passage of Jesus, and I know you're gonna be like, "Really? You're comparing it to a dog?" I can't help think about this story, because 4 pages of instruction. And I listen to Jesus' prayer. And underneath it, as I listen to him talk to God the Father about us, his children, that he's leaving behind as he prepares to go to the cross to die for our sins, I listen to him ramble for quite a long time. We only really of this prayer get this short snippet, but actually the prayer goes on for almost 3 chapters. And I listen to Jesus give God instructions, because he's worried about us. He's worried about us, his disciples, who he loves and cares for and has been watching out for his entire life's journey on earth. And as he prepares to die for our sins and give us the promise of a brand new beginning and eternal life and free us from sin and death forever, he knows still that even though he's taught us all that there is, well, not all that there is to teach us, but all that he's had time to teach us along the journey, he knows that there's still going to be trouble and that we're still living in the world and that sin is still a reality even though there's forgiveness and that there's struggles along the way. And who's going to keep us safe when he's not right there? Because you see, that's the way it's been, right? The way that it's been with him and his disciples has been a hands-on experience. Jesus called each one of those disciples by name. He walked with them on his journey through earth and taught them along the way. When he noticed that people were hungry or scared or hurting, he brought healing and he fed them. When the disciples had questions and concerns and were wrestling, he talked to them. And he wouldn't always ease their concerns, because maybe easing the concerns isn't the right answer to the problem, but he'd discuss it and he'd sit with them and he'd guide them. He just washed each one of those disciples' feet and cleansed them and forgave them and told them that they are all part of him in some way. But he knows that he's about to face the cross. And he knows that in the next 24 hours, all the disciples are going to flee, because even though he's taught them all of these things and he's taught them to trust in the Lord, they're going to be afraid. And he knows that that is just the beginning of the journey, really. Because when he sends them out to serve and to spread the gospel, there's going to be other challenges to come. So here he is, praying to the Father. And he tells God, "I have taught them all that there is to teach them about the commandments, and I've taught them your word, and they've learned your word, and they've kept your word, and they know it, and they're grounded, Lord. But the world, protect them in my name." And I can just imagine, that this prayer is a whole lot like my sister-in-law sitting and writing 4 pages of instructions before she goes on the trip, because you see, this dog is her baby. I might have written close to 4 pages of instructions when I gave my babies to my parents the first time I left them when I went on a trip. It's what we do when we love somebody and we can't be there to be helpful and to have feelings like we have just a piece of a little bit of control. When everything feels like it's out of control, the thing we do is write some directions for somebody else, right? And Jesus has some concerns. So he turns to the Lord and he says, Lord, these children are yours. I'm yours. They're yours. You've protected me. Protect them in my name. Can you hear the bossiness in this prayer? Did you hear it? And yet, when we love somebody and we feel like we just don't know or can't be there to help the way that we'd like to be, don't we pray sometimes in similar ways? Lord, I'm going for a few days and my parents are going to watch the kids and protect them in your name. Please watch over them and take care of them and help them to come back in one piece without a broken thumb this time and so forth and so on, right? And Lord, this person I love deeply, is going to have surgery tomorrow. And I can't be there to hold their hand because I have to sit in the waiting room. But they're yours and I'm yours. So Lord, protect them. Protect them. And Lord, I don't know what the future looks like ahead exactly. Because one thing has ended in my life and another thing is about to begin. A new job or whatever. And we're, as a family, about to head off to a new beginning. And life is feeling pretty out of control, but I'm yours and they're yours, and so, Lord, protect us, please. Don't we know this prayer? This prayer that Jesus prayed. And in the end, when we pray this prayer, it's a gift. Because it does two different things, doesn't it? First, it carries our hearts to God and entrusts those hearts to the Lord of heaven and earth, who has promised to protect us, who in fact gave his Son to die for our sins, who promises to be there even in the midst of death itself, who promises that there will never be a time when we are without the love of the Lord. And it also brings some peace to even the one who is praying the prayer. Because in the end, every moment of life is outside of our control. So as we pray this prayer and we ask God to protect and guide, we're reminded of where our trust lies. And we're reminded that everything is uncontrollable. And yet, God has protected and guided us all this journey. And that doesn't change. So somewhere in the midst of the prayer, we're reminded and encouraged to remember to trust. The next day, Christ will die on the cross for our sins. And then all new life will begin. God is trustworthy. Always. So we carry our loved ones to the Lord in prayer, just as Christ carries us to the Lord in prayer. And we trust that God's got us, always. The next part of Jesus' prayer is kind of interesting. He says, protect them from the evil of the world. What do you think about that? Do you always think about the world as evil, as a whole? I tend to see a lot of good in the world, too. But these disciples are going to be sent out to share God's love with the world. And God's radical love takes the world by shock many, many times, and by storm, and people often don't know what to do with it or feel threatened by it in some way or another. As soon as the disciples start carrying Christ's love and unconditional love and forgiveness to the world, there are all kinds of people who will be rattled by the word. And so Christ prays for their protection. But is it just the disciples who are specifically going to a new place to share God's word that Jesus is praying for? I think it's all of us. I think when we know Christ's love and forgiveness and joy and healing and promise that God never lets us go, I think all of us start to look at the world differently and start to have an entire different way of going about living. And that often, even those little differences that happen in our lives begin to take the world by storm and begin to rattle people. Have you ever rattled people by the way that Jesus makes you think? Jesus is praying for protection and for some guidance from God in the middle of the things that might rattle the world whenever we come and encounter those moments. An example? I think there are probably all kinds of them. But I have a confession. I've been watching old Disney lately. When I say old, I'm talking about like movies from before the time I was born. Old. I happened to come across the movie Pollyanna, thanks to Disney Plus the other day. It's an old movie, and maybe many of you haven't seen it, but maybe many of you have. The story is about a missionary girl who has lost both of her parents. And so she gets shipped off to her aunt, who actually is quite wealthy and pretty much owns an entire town and controls it because of the money that she has. She even coaches the pastor on how to preach a sermon so that the pastor tends to preach the message that she wants to hear and she wants the town to hear every single week. The message is generally, stay the course and keep God's commandments or they'll be hell to pay for it. That's the message of the town. So Pollyanna shows up, fresh off the train, having just lost her parents, clinging to the love of God that her missionary parents have taught her. Missionary parents have taught her to look for joy and to be thankful and glad, even when life is not exactly what you want it to be, because it will make your heart happier and because God has a funny way of providing sometimes. So she steps off the train and she immediately begins telling everybody about the things that she's glad about. Like she's glad to get to have her own room for the very first time in her life. But the room is on the very tip-top corner of the mansion in the midst of the attic where all the junk is stored. She walks into this dusty, dusty corner of a beautiful home and is told, this is your place. And she says, I'm so glad I have my own room. And look, it's got a beautiful window. And the maid humphs. Because seriously, this is the worst room in the whole house. But she's glad about it. Genuinely glad. And it begins that gladness to change people. She walks into the room of a lady who's decided that she needs to die, or she's going to die because she's getting old. And she says to the lady, oh, but look, you have prisms on your chandeliers. They make rainbows. There's joy in watching the rainbows. I wish I had some rainbows to look at every day. And pretty soon, she and the lady are building quilts together. Because there's more to life than dying. And because even when you're sick, there are things around you to find joy in. one person at a time that she encounters in town. She greets with a smile, and she tells them in one way or another that she's thankful for them. And every time she does, she's met with a couple responses. Often, they look at her with a nonplussed expression like, seriously, kid, how can you find joy in this? Often, they get frustrated with her and begin to list all of the reasons why there is not joy. But slowly but surely, many of them begin to warm to this girl because they realize that the joy she's talking about is authentically part of who she is. And it comes not from her, but from God. And they are longing with all their hearts, with all their being, to have just a little bit of that joy. It's such a little thing, this joy in the movie. But I think we've all come up against it, haven't we? We've all had moments when we are living in the joy of Christ, even though life isn't perfect, and expressing some of that joy when other people look at us and go, really? Are you that naive? The world can crush easily the love of God. But Christ for each of us, that we might cling to that love and joy, and that we may trust that even in the midst of our most dire circumstances, Christ is with us and will not let us go, and death has power over us, and that in that differently. Ways. Ones. But Christ is for us to hold fast and to cling to the because we have need to share, and because the world desperately trust in the Lord, and don't let the world crush it. Amen. Thanks be to God. Our faith in God in whom we place our lives and our trust. We use the words of the Apostles' Creed in our bulletins. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified by the Holy Spirit,
Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Holy God, in Christ Jesus, the joy of the church is made complete. Root the church in your word and unify us as Christ's body. Send us into the whole world as your loving people, ready to testify to your Spirit at work. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Mighty God, the world is your handiwork. Display your creative impulse. Seize him with life. Forests reach up and praise you. The mysteries of life lies deep in the soil. Bless this season of planting and all who tend to the soil and all that grows. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Gracious Sovereign, those who follow your ways are like trees planted near streams of water. Establish the leaders of nations and all in authority of your grace and truth, within your grace and truth. Strengthen them so that the people they serve will have abundant life. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Generous Savior, you befriend those who are sick, suffering, poor, lonely, outcast, rejected, or sick. Grant healing and love to all who are in need. Especially we pray for Bev, Wally, Lois, Gert, Chris, Joe, and all that we lift up in the silence of our hearts. Give them tangible signs of your steadfast love. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Creator God, in this community, we share the gifts of praying, learning, and supporting one another. Thank you, Lord, for our Sunday school teachers who have faithfully shared the stories of your love, forgiveness, strength, and grace with their students. Even as we enjoy a different schedule this summer, fill us with your Spirit that we may continue to grow in faith, hope, and love. Bless those who are graduating this spring. Guide them as they journey forward, that they may discover the callings that you have for their lives. Bless the end of the school year for everyone. Give us joy in noticing the ways that you have helped us grow. Provide rest through the summer's change of pace and bring us back ready to learn and grow again soon. Especially, Lord, we thank you for all of the ways that you have helped us muddle through COVID this year. Please continue to bring healing to your world and continue to help us through all that is. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Saving God, your wonderful promise is the gift of eternal life in Jesus. Through this witness, through the witness of those who have died in you, strengthen us now at this table with this gift of life. We cherish the ministry of your the memory of your saints, especially we pray for the family of Bob Riddle and all the families who mourn the death of loved ones. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please turn to your neighbors and share that peace today. Let us pray. God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ. Amen. Communion today is served at the altar, or if you'd prefer, you can receive it in the pew as well. If you're going to receive it in the pew, please prepare your elements at this time and raise them with me as we bless them and remember the goodness of God's forgiveness and grace that we are invited to receive here. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The meal is ready, and all are welcome at this table. Please come forward as the ushers give instruction, receiving communion at the altar, and then returning the communion glasses to the basket by the baptismal font. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you forever in his grace and love. Amen. Let us pray. Wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness into our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us and send us as a joyful witness that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We are sent out to love and serve God with our lives. We go with God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. This is the last Sunday of Easter, so next Sunday when we gather, it will be Pentecost Sunday, and we will celebrate the good news of God's Holy Spirit, and if you'd like to, red is the color of the day, just FYI. And the CDC has changed its recommendations. The city of Lincoln still has a mask mandate through May 22nd, so whatever the city of Lincoln decides, we live in the town of Lincoln, we will follow the law of our land. So pay attention to what the mask mandates are, but that will be our congregation's guidance. We will follow what the city has to say on things and move forward as the city recommends. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.